Welcome to Parks Unseen. I'm your host, Liam Wolf. Tonight, we dive deep into the hidden archives of the National Park Service, uncovering reports that have never seen the light of day until now. Thanks to an anonymous source, we've received a box of reports from the 1970s and 1980s, where brave park rangers documented their eerie encounters with beings beyond our understanding. These are their stories, unfiltered and unedited. There are a number of these reports from all over the country, and from my research, it seems like there was a pretty successful attempt to cover them up back in the day. But as we know, all truths come to light eventually, no matter how deep they may be buried. We know the former owner of these reports intended them to go public at some point, but the timing was never right. From what I can gather, he was afraid the world wasn't ready to know the truth about these creatures. As for me, I figure now is as good of time as any. If there are indeed monsters lurking in our national parks, people deserve to know about them. Pretending they don't exist isn't going to make us any safer out there. In fact, it's likely to do just the opposite. So without further ado, let's jump right into our report for the evening. This one comes from Yellowstone. For the sake of privacy, we've chosen to keep the identity of the ranger anonymous. Date, August 15, 1974. Case ID number 42. Location, East Yellowstone Boneyard. Time, 7:45 p.m. There's a space here to fill in the type of incident which the ranger records as wildlife encounter with a question mark behind it. I'll read you the next part of the report verbatim. Saw an animal at the Eastern Boneyard, non-native species, unable to identify. Those were the opening words of the report. The ranger then goes on to describe the encounter in detail. I think I found out what's been scaring the bears off the boneyard on the east side of the park. I drove down there with a fresh deer carcass that had been hit earlier in the day off Highway 14. A little bit too close to the park, so I picked it up. I drove it down to the boneyard around 7:45 p.m. It was quiet when I got there. The scavengers had completely stripped an elk that we had dropped 2 days prior. I backed the truck up to the dump site and got out to throw the deer out. There was something in the woods. I couldn't see it, but I could hear it just beyond the trees. Figured it was a bear, so I hurriedly dropped the deer and got back into the truck. I waited in the cab to see if anything was going to come out. When it gets that quiet in the woods, larger predators are around. The boneyard was always a quiet place, but there was definitely something out there. I had the camera in the truck with me. We had some reports of a large brown bear in the area earlier in the year. I've gathered those reports and I'll send them in, along with this one. I was hoping to get a photograph of the bear. That's what I thought it was. The animals around the boneyard had been acting strangely for weeks. The normal visitors were being scared off by something. The other rangers and I figured it was the bear. I waited in the cab for a moment until I saw something come out of the trees. I've attached the photograph I took of it. I don't know what else to write here. This is not a native species. I do not know what it is. It was larger than an adult, male grizzly. The face looked wolfish. This is something we've never dealt with before. The animal came out of the trees and growled at my truck. It clearly wanted to claim the carcass and thought my truck was too close. Its body language was threatening, but the animal did not approach. I quickly snapped the photograph and drove away. The same protocol I would have taken with a bear encounter. I didn't want to chance anything. As I left, the animal cautiously approached the carcass and began to eat it. None of the other scavengers were in the area that I could see. I'm afraid this thing has begun to rely on us for food. I don't know if it will venture closer to human spaces or not. I'm suggesting we move the dump site even further away from the park trails. This is beyond any of us here at the Park Service. We are reaching out to higher authorities for advice. We'll continue to monitor the range of the creature until we receive further instructions. As of this time, we don't believe the park needs to be closed. We have decided to limit camping accommodations and backcountry permits for now. That's the end of the report. We were unable to recover the accompanying reports of the large bear sighting, but we do have the photograph the ranger took of the creature. It's a little dated, but you can see it all clear enough. The creature in the photograph appears to be a frightening mix of a wolf and a bear. It is resting between two trees and is showing its teeth, which coincides with the ranger's claim that it was trying to get him to back off of a deer carcass. The ears are small but pointed, and there seems to be some lighter colored facial markings around its brow and muzzle. The hair is dark, but we can still see that it is long and shaggy. Whatever this thing is, it looks like it has adapted to harsh winter climates, and it is very clearly not a bear, but what is it? The park ranger didn't have any idea, and we didn't find any further written information on the incident or what happened afterward. This is an intriguing case. We don't often get clear photographs like this, and there are no known animals that line up with the image we are seeing. After reading the report for the first time, I started doing a little digging. I couldn't track down the ranger who made the report, but I did manage to find a colleague of his that was willing to talk to me. This person wanted to remain anonymous, stating that they still live and work in the area. Small town and all that. Not everyone wants to be associated with cryptid investigations, so for the rest of the program, I'll simply refer to this person as Jay. 1974 was Jay's second season working at Yellowstone. Jay told me that all the parks in the Rockies were taking extra precautions following the nightmarish 1967 grizzly attacks at Glacier National Park. Those attacks changed everything. Bear lockers were installed at campsites, and the rangers were diligently reminding visitors to be bear aware. Trails with suspected bear activity were immediately shut down until the bears moved on. And then there was the creation of the bone yards that the ranger talks about in the report. There were several of these bone yards around Yellowstone National Park, and they are still there today, though you would never know it. The bone yards are essentially carcass dumps. Every year, there are a multitude of vehicular incidents with wildlife around the park. If the carcasses are left to decay along the roadsides, well, that's basically ringing the dinner bell for all the large predators in the area. And that means a higher likelihood to have a dangerous encounter with some of the park visitors. Jay said it was a big problem in the park, and as soon as something was killed on the road, it had to be picked up by one of the rangers and taken to the boneyard. Now, the rangers like to keep pretty quiet about the boneyards. They're basically a free buffet for all the predators in the area, and from the sound of it, it can get wild out there. Jay said it wasn't safe to get out of the truck when they went out to dump a carcass, and that sometimes there would be animals there waiting at the edge of the tree line. If you stayed and watched, you could see them fighting over the carcasses. Wolves, bears, coyotes, eagles, vultures, ravens, they'd all be there. Sometimes simultaneously. The bone yards aren't accessible to the public for obvious reasons. The entire reason they were created was to keep close encounters with the park's large predators to a minimum. I mean, imagine the chaos that would ensue if people were allowed in. With the number of people that get out of their cars in attempts to pet bison and moose, someone would undoubtedly get far too close, and that would be that. The bone yards are kept in secret, remote locations. You'd have to go well off the marked trails to find them, and that isn't something I recommend you try doing. My interview with Jay led me on an interesting investigation. Jay never saw the creature detailed in the report, but remembered some other odd occurrences at the boneyard before August 15th. They would drop off fresh carcasses, often deer and goats, but none of the usuals were around. Not even the coyotes or the vultures. Something was scaring them off. Normally, the animals managed to share on some level, even if it was just the little scavengers hanging around the edges waiting to sneak in for a quick bite. But there was a presence in the forest that kept the others at bay. And yet, the carcasses would be cleaned out in a day or less. There was something out there that claimed the East Bone Yard that summer, and nothing, not a single creature, was willing to try its luck. Not even the grizzlies. Jay told me that the creature was undoubtedly lured in by the food they were providing it. There was a lot of talk around the ranger station, but no one would come out and say what they thought it was. One of the older, senior rangers mentioned that it likely came down from Canada. He said, and I quote, "There are some things up there in the north that shouldn't be, but they don't venture down here very often." Jay was pretty spooked upon hearing that, but too frightened to ask what he meant. Jay gave me the name of the senior ranger, but my investigation found that he had passed some years ago, so it would seem our dig for the truth was going to be more difficult than I had previously thought. After the sighting of the creature, the Park Service stopped supplying it with food. The bone yards were abandoned that year, and the carcasses along the park roads had to either be taken to a rendering plant or buried deep enough that the bears and wolves wouldn't try to dig them up. Eventually, the creature moved on, and interestingly enough, it had no encounters with any of the park visitors. In fact, it seems that it went out of its way to remain undiscovered. But what was it? The report the ranger made describes it with a wolf-like face, and we can see from the photo that it definitely has some distinctly canine characteristics, but I think there's something more going on here. Even from the front-facing angle, we can see its muzzle is shorter and wider than that of a wolf. In fact, it looks more like the snout of a bear. Which leads me to my next theory. There have been whispers coming down from the far north regions of Canada for many years. Whispers of living relics from an age thought to be long past. I had heard some of these theories in years past, but I'll be honest, I dismissed them without much thought, believing them to be nothing more than folkloric superstitions and myths to be told around campfires. But that photo got me thinking that it might not be as outlandish as it sounds. Maybe, just maybe, some of them did manage to survive. I took a trip to the Idaho Museum of Natural History. There, they have a permanent Ice Age fossil exhibit, and there were a couple of specimens I wanted to see for myself, the first being the dire wolf. It might interest you to know that these creatures are not actually related to the modern gray wolf at all. Their skeletons look similar at first glance, but DNA testing reveals they have no common lineage. If you compare the skulls, the dire wolf skull is wider and broader than a gray wolf, but the dire wolf isn't actually all that much larger in body than our modern wolves. If we believe the ranger's report on the creature's estimated size, this likely eliminates the dire wolf from the list of suspects. My next visit was to the skeleton of the giant short-faced bear. The skull of the short-faced bear looks almost like a cross between a wolf and a bear. The average specimen is around 5 to 6 feet at the shoulder, and that's just when it's on four legs. Like all other bears, these guys can stand up, and when they do, they can be over 12 feet tall. They were the largest land predator of their time. And maybe, if my theory holds water, they still are. You look at all these legends of giant wolves in the north, and if you actually listen to the descriptions of the creatures, they aren't even wolves at all. They are described with characteristics of both bears and wolves, all of them. Some encounters even describe the creature as having the body of a hyena, which, if you think about it, is roughly the same shape as a bear. Could the giant short-faced bear have somehow survived into the modern day? By all scientific investigations, they all disappeared some 12,500 years ago. Of course, the next theory is that of the fabled Dogman. I'm sure most of you have heard of the Dogman before. A large bipedal canine with the body of a man and the head of a dog or a wolf. Reports of the creature all say it stands taller than a human man. There have been reported sightings of this creature all over the United States. The most notable incident was in Michigan, but since then, people across the country have claimed to have encounters with the creature. Its most frightening aspect is its ability to stand on two legs like a human, or maybe like a bear. Might this cryptid have some connection to the giant short-faced bear? I think there could be something there, but I'll let you decide for yourself. One of the major critiques of cryptid theories is the undeniable lack of evidence. If there are indeed unknown monsters out there, then why haven't we found any bodies, any hair or DNA? If they live, they must die. And while we know that scavengers will make quick work of a carcass in the wilderness, there still must be something left behind of their existence. Now, if we are looking for cold, hard proof, then it is an undisputable fact that these prehistoric creatures lived on the North American continent. The question I have for you is, could they still be alive out there somewhere, concealed in the undisturbed wilderness of the North? Or perhaps we are looking at a totally new species. If that old park ranger was right and this thing did come down from Canada, well, there's quite a bit of the Northern Territories that are uninhabitable, dense wilderness. It's not an impossible thought that there could be undiscovered species living in the remote wilderness up there. There are legends of uncontacted human tribes, Arctic rainforests, giant wolves, and even living mammoths coming out of northern Canada. So much of the north is only accessible by bush plane, and even then, much of it is still unexplored. There could be just about anything out there in the wilds, and we wouldn't necessarily know about it. I don't know about you, but I think there's a very real chance that some of these Ice Age animals might not be extinct after all. Let me know what you all think in the comments. Did our park ranger encounter a prehistoric bear in the boneyard on that summer evening in 1974? Or was it the Dogman of local lore? Or perhaps it was something else, something new. We may never know.